Hello.
Today we'll be discussing about Hindu Marriage Act. So marriage is an interesting subject. So before discussing about the marriage law, when you look into the act, it says Hindu Marriage Act. So it is very clear the term Hindu means this law applies to a particular religious people. So that is people who belong to Hindu community. This marriage provision is applicable. Now, before looking into the Hindu Marriage Act, we'll just discuss who are those Hindus to whom this provision is applicable. So when you say Hindu, Hindu may be by birth, where the parents are Hindus, or by conversion, that is when a person was born as a Christian or a Mohammedan, he converts to Hinduism, he is also considered as a Hindu. So to these person, Hindu law is applicable, and to these person, Hindu Marriage Act is applicable. Right. Now, why this act came into existence, you have to have the knowledge about the historical background. So when you look into the historical background, you would have seen that as far as India is concerned, the marriage is performed by following various customs and religious practices, which includes, it may be a betrothal, kanyadana, panigrahana, saptapadi, mangalyadharana, so on and so forth. So why marriage is considered as an essential part of a ceremony in Hinduism is that it is said there are so many sanskaras which is performed in a man's life, but marriage is a mandatory part of his life. Why? Reason is that it is said you have to get married and have a son, that is putra. Now why you have to have a son is that the son is the one who has to perform the last rites for the father, as well as he is going to offer the pindadana to the ancestors also. So that is the reason you say you should have a son. That is one reason. Second reason is that only if a married person can perform the religious and spiritual ceremonies in order to get the complete benefit out of that ceremony, whatever he performs. So these are the main reason why marriage is considered as an essential part of a man's life. Right. Now when you talk about the father's duty, when you talk about a daughter, right from the birth to death, there are various sanskaras or ceremonies are performed, but marriage is most important part of the ceremony or a obligation which a father has to perform in order to attain the moksha, it is said. Right. So once a woman is legally married by performing all the essential conditions, then she gets the status of Dharmapatni or Ardhangi, and she has all the rights to perform all the pujas, take care of the household, so on and so forth. Right. This is one part. Now we'll just look into the what is the system which was prevalent in those times. Now, as far as marriage is concerned, a man can have any number of wives, but a woman can marry only once in a lifetime. Next, we had the concept of child marriage. So, in case a girl is married at the age of 8 years and the boy dies when the girl reaches around 10 or 12 years, she is considered as a widow and she is prohibited from, or she is prevented from remarrying again, and lifelong she is considered as a widow. Another evil which was prevalent in those times was the caste system. So there was absolute restriction as far as intercaste marriage was concerned. So in order to overcome all these evils, this act called as Hindu Marriage Act came into existence. Right. Now what are the essential conditions you have to comply in order to declare a marriage as a valid one? The first condition, it says that monogamy. So what is monogamy is that, as I told you before the passing of the act, a man can have any number of wives. But here it says that at the time of marriage, the party to the marriage should not have a living spouse. That means the man should not have a living wife, or the women should not have a living husband. So in case they have a living spouse, then it is said that they have committed an offense of bigamy, which is punishable in Hindu Marriage Act under Section 17 as well as the Indian Penal Code. So this is the first essential condition. Now, second essential condition is age of majority. I told you we had a child marriage system. So it made it very clear that child marriage should be prohibited. So first we had the Child Marriage Restraint Act, and now we have the prohibition of child marriage under section under 2006. Now what does this act says? It says a girl below the age of 18 years, a boy below the age of 21 years is considered to be a child. So in case a marriage is performed where the children are below the specified age of 18 and 21, then marriage is not declared as void, but they are given an option when these children, that is minor, when they attain the age of majority, if the girl attains the age of 18 years or the boy attains the age of 21 years, they are given an option where they can declare the marriage to be null and void through the court order saying that it was a child marriage. Now coming to the parents who have performed the marriage, they are liable to be punished for performing the child marriage. Okay, that is about the age of majority. Now coming to the third essential is that soundness of mind, that means the mental capacity. So the boy and the girl should be in a position to give a valid consent for the marriage. In case if the girl or a boy was suffering from mental incapacity, or they have the recurrent attack of epilepsy where they are not in a position to give a valid consent, then they are disqualified for the marital relationship. And such kind of subject or such kind of defects which is not disclosed to the other party, it may be a ground for declaring that marriage as void ab initio. Now coming to the fourth condition is that it is called as prohibited relationship. So law says under these relationship you cannot marry. So what are those relationship? For example, a person cannot marry mother's sister, father's brother, your sister-in-law, your brother-in-law. These are considered to be prohibited. But in certain cases, the law says that you cannot marry mother's brother or mother's brother's son, father's sister's son, but it says in case there is a custom which has been prevailing in that particular community where the maternal uncle can be married, or you can marry maternal uncle's son or paternal aunt's daughter, then it does not come under a restriction. Marriage is valid. But what is the object of imposing such restriction is that children born out of this relationship will have mental and physical degeneracy. That is the object. This is the fourth condition. Now coming to the fifth condition is that it is prohibiting sapinda relationship. Now what is sapinda relationship is that we all know about the joint family system. So you have a karta. Karta may have around 6 to 7 children, and they in turn will be having at least 3 children, and it goes on like that. So 3 or 4 generation are living together in your family. So what happens here? When the karta dies, the son is having a duty to perform the funeral rites, and the grandchildren and great grandchildren will be performing the pindadana, offering pindadana, because they are related to a common ancestor. So what it says that these person who are related to common ancestor, having a common karta and the branches, It is said that they are related through blood, or really they are offering pindadana to common ancestor, so they cannot marry among themselves. They are considered as brothers and sisters. So these are the five essentials which has to be taken care when a marriage is performed among the Hindus. Right. Now coming to the ceremonies, there is no restriction. So depending upon your custom you are going to perform, it may be Mangalya Dharana, your Saptapati or Kanyaka Dana, so on and so forth. Now the Supreme Court has seen so many cases where when a woman approaches a court for maintenance, she was not able to prove that she is a legally wedded wife. So in order to protect the interest of the women, the Supreme Court in the year 2006, Seema versus Ashwini Kumar, gave a direction that irrespective of the religion, all the marriages should be registered. So it gave a direction to all the state governments and central government to carry out the direction within a period of 3 months from the date of the decree. Okay, now ceremonies is over. Now what is next? There starts the problem. Now in case there is an issue between the husband and wife, what is the remedy? In the situation before the passing of the act, we said the concept of dissolution of marriage was not there. So in this act, it is provided for various remedies where in case the parties to the marriage are not in a position to continue their marital relationship, there are various remedies available in the Hindu Marriage Act. Now we'll take up the first remedy. It is called as restitution of conjugal right. So once a man and a woman is married, they have mutual rights and obligation, right to consortium, in case any spouse leaves the matrimonial home without any reasonable excuse, without the consent of other spouse, then the aggrieved spouse can approach the court, request the court to give a direction to the spouse who has left the matrimonial home to come back. So that is called as you're asking for restoration of your conjugal rights. So that is why it is called as conjugal rights. Right, here we would like to discuss one case law, that is Sarita versus Venkata Subbaya. So you all know about Sarita, who was a leading cine actress in the 60s and 70s. She had an interest in acting in movies, but she couldn't get any chance. But she got a lot of chances to act in movies after her marriage. So she settled in Chennai and her husband was in Andhra. So he requested Sarita to come back and perform her matrimonial obligation, but Sarita refused because she was busy with her shooting work. And she in turn asked her husband to come back to Chennai, come down to Chennai. So Venkata Subbaya, he filed a petition in Andhra court for restitution of conjugal right, and court gave a direction to Sarita to come back to the matrimonial home, that is where her husband was residing. But Sarita went for an appeal to Andhra Pradesh High Court, and there she contested that this provision, section 9, restitution of conjugal rights, was violating her fundamental rights, that is right to equality and right to life and liberty, because she has a right to choose her profession and do what she wants the best in her life. So by only because she's been married to Venkata Subbaya, she cannot be compelled to come back to the matrimonial home, take care of the household chores and give birth to children. So the court accepted that yes, section 9 was violating article 14 and 21 of the constitution, and decree of divorce was granted. But a similar case went to the Supreme Court, that is Saroj Rani's case versus Sudarshan Kumar, where the court made it very clear the intention of the provision is not to separate the parties to the marriage but to reconcile. So in the actual meaning, when you are interpreting, we can come to the conclusion section 9 is not a violating provision as far as fundamental right is concerned. Right. We'll move on to the next provision, that is called as judicial separation. So in judicial separation, the word itself is say that the judiciary separates the parties to the marriage for a period of 1 year, right? So here you have to prove certain grounds. So what are the grounds on which you can seek judicial separation is that adultery. So what is adultery is that in case the husband or wife has committed an illicit or having an illicit relationship with any women or men other than the spouse, you call it as adultery, and a single act is sufficient for seeking the remedy under this ground. Second ground is called as cruelty. Now what is cruelty? It is not been defined, because what is cruelty to me may not be a cruelty to you. So it differs from case to case. So depending upon the case, the court is going to decide whether it amounts to, that particular act amounts to cruelty or not. So when you say cruelty, you can classify into physical cruelty and mental cruelty. So what is physical cruelty is that if the husband is a drunkard and he beats the wife regularly, it is a physical assault or physical cruelty. Or he abuses the wife in presence of everyone, ill treats her, all this comes under mental cruelty. So when you say cruelty, our presumption is it is always the husband is ill treating the wife, but there are many instances where the wife also ill treats the husband, both physical and mental also. There are a lot of cases, right? So this is the second ground. Now coming to the third ground is called as desertion. Now what is desertion is that in case the parties to the marriage has left the matrimonial home without reasonable cause and the duration of separation is exceeding more than 2 years, then it comes under definition of desertion. Right, desertion is over. Next is that leprosy. So here leprosy means it is now curable. Suppose you are able to prove it is of virulent form and communicable form, yes, it is a ground. Next is if the other spouse is suffering from venereal disease like HIV, AIDS, so on and so forth, again that is another ground. Or presumed death, if person is not heard for more than 7 years. So all these are various grounds where both the husband and wife can file a petition under section 9 for judicial separation. Now what you have to remember in judicial separation is that in this 1 year, the husband and wife will be residing separately, but still the marital tie continues. In case in this duration of 1 year, if the husband or wife enter into the next marriage, then they can be punished for bigamy, right? And there is no need of performing mutual obligation. Women is an independent person, but within this period of 1 year, at any time they can start cohabiting with each other. So that is called as judicial separation. Now moving on to the next concept is called as divorce. So now what is divorce is that both the parties are separated and there is no more relationship as an husband and wife. So here also the party seeking for divorce should prove certain grounds. Okay, so if the grounds are available to both husband and wife, and certain grounds are available only to the wife. So grounds are more or less similar to what we discussed in the judicial separation, like adultery, cruelty, you have desertion, you have venereal disease, leprosy, and coming to the conversion. Now when a person converts, husband or wife converts, and if the other spouse is not happy with the conversion, then it may be a ground for filing a petition for divorce. Suppose if there is no objection, then they can continue as a husband and wife. There is no restriction. Next is that you talk about renunciation of the world. Now usually what happens in the family is that if there is a dispute, immediate declaration by the husband is he want to take up sannyasa. Now, just by declaring that he is going to take up sannyasa or wearing a saffron cloth cannot be considered as that he has renounced the world and it is a ground for divorce. But there is a procedure. What is the procedure? Is that he has to perform various sanskaras. In that last one is that he will be performing his own shraddha, death ceremony, where he declares that he is no more attached to the materialistic world nor his family members, and then he leaves the place for meditation. So only when all these essential ceremonies are performed, you declare that person has taken up sannyasa or he has renounced the world, and that may be a ground for divorce. Right. So next we are talking about the additional grounds what is available to the wife. Now, when we talk about the additional grounds available to the wife is that in case the husband has committed an offense of rape or he has committed an offense of bigamy, then that may be a ground for divorce for the wife. So these are the grounds where, or the remedies where, the parties have to prove their grounds. But in 1976, this Marriage Act was amended and a new provision was included called as mutual concern divorce, that is 13B. Now what does it say? So here the parties to the marriage, that is husband and wife, file a common petition seeking the court to grant them a mutual consent divorce. So what is the ground they are going to state is that they have been married for a period of 1 year and they are not able to live together from past 1 year, and they have mutually agreed to separate, and the court is satisfied that there is no coercion or undue influence or misrepresentation. If the court is satisfied, then mutual consent divorce can be given. Suppose it finds that there was coercion, and the court may dismiss the petition of mutual consent divorce. Right. Now we have covered the remedies. What is next? Maintenance is the next one. So when you talk about the maintenance, you can classify into two. One is during the pendency of litigation. So if the wife is not in a position to maintain herself during the petition of divorce or whatever it is, then she can request the court for granting of maintenance depending upon whether she is alone or she has children. So once the suit is decreed, then the court may grant permanent alimony. Right? This is one part. The second part of maintenance is that a wife will be residing separately, marriage is not dissolved, but still she is entitled for maintenance. Now what is this right to claim maintenance by residing separately? Is that in case the wife is able to prove the husband has deserted her. Here you talk about desertion is constructive desertion is there. What is constructive desertion is that wife is having no intention to leave the matrimonial home, but if the husband brings his mistress or a concubine to the house and requests the wife to adjust with her, then it is a mental agony created in the mind of the wife, and in case it compels the wife to leave the matrimonial home, later on if the husband files a petition that wife has deserted and it is a valid ground for divorce, the court will reject the petition on the ground that the reason why the wife left the matrimonial home was not she was at fault, but the husband had created a circumstances by bringing his concubine or mistress to his house, and that is the cause which forced her, compelled the wife to leave the matrimonial home. Right? That is one ground where wife can claim the maintenance. Or next is cruelty, or husband is suffering from venereal disease or leprosy. On all these grounds, what happened? Marriage tie is retained, but she'll be claiming the maintenance. How long she can claim maintenance? Now, so long she does not get married, or so long she does not have any other source of income, or she does not become unchaste. Now we discussed all these things from the point of view of the women. Now there is also a provision where husband is unemployed, wife is well employed and financially sound, then husband also can file a petition for maintenance from the wife. So that's about the maintenance what we have discussed, right? Now we'll move on to the next most important issue, a burning issue what we all are facing the moment you say marriage. Yes, the first dealing or contract is what is the amount of dowry you are going to get. So when you say dowry, you have to go back why this act came into existence. When in earlier days, what happened, the parents used to give jewelries, property, it may be movable or immovable property, the girl, that is their daughter. The intention of giving this was, in case of distress, this property will come to their rescue. So there was no demand, it was given out of love and affection, depending upon the capacity of the girl's father. But slowly what happened, it converted into a demand. So because the demand had raised to such an extent, it resulted in the death of the wife within a short period of marriage, bride burning, it was necessary to come out with an enactment, and that is called as Dowry Prohibition Act 1961. Now usually what we, the concept which is been used interchangeably is that dowry and sridhana are one and the same. Sridhana is different and dowry is different. Now what is sridhana? Just look into the word. It is sri and dhana. So sri is women and dhana is property. So when you talk about the women's right to property, right from the birth till the death, I told you there are so many sanskaras performed or ceremonies performed where the girl is given lot of gifts, property, out of love and affection from the mother, father, brother, relatives, and she would have earned the property or government would have granted the property. It goes on like that. So all this property what a woman acquires right from birth till the death, it is her property, a woman's property, a sridhana. And in this property what she has acquired, she is considered to be an absolute owner and she has a right to dispose it in whatever manner she wants. There is no restriction there. In case she dies without executing will, it passes on to her legal representatives as if in the mode of succession. Hindu Succession Act is there. Right? So that is called as sridhana. But when you talk about dowry, it is the property which is given at the time of marriage. It is a demand given to the boy or the boy's family or relatives. Right? So that's why it is called as dowry. So dowry is different, sridhana is different. Now what is a dowry? Dowry may be in the form of cash, security, property, movable, immovable, whatever it is having a valuable asset, right? What does the section says? So dowry means, dowry demand means whatever is been given before the marriage, at the time of marriage, after the marriage, by the girl's parents to the boy or boy's parents or boy's relative, it comes under definition of dowry. And dowry giving and taking is considered to be a punishable offense. Right. Next concept is that usually what we do, because we have a Dowry Prohibition Act, giving, taking, demand, everything is a punishment. Now the procedure what is adopted is that there is no direct demand. So what they say is that we don't want any dowry, but for your daughter's sake, whatever you want to do, you can give her. We don't have a car. For her sake, you can give a car. We don't have our own property. For her sake, you give her an apartment, or you can give her a plot, or for her sake, you can give the jewelry. So the list develops, but it is in the, not in the name of a demand. It is for the sake of their own daughter, for her interest, for her well-being. So that also comes under definition of dowry demand, right? So now you have a procedure. What is the procedure? How the rules has been enacted? Usually this rule was already there when you attend the marriages in the village. Usually after the Mangali Dharana, you would have seen people with a notebook who will write down the name of the person who is giving the present, what is his relative, what is the amount he has given, right? This book is retained. One intention is that you have to pay back the amount in case in that family there is a function. And another objective of giving the gift in the form of money is that, so because the marriage has been performed, there will be financial problem will be there. So to some extent, to help the girl's family, this will come to their rescue. So that is being incorporated in this act, Dowry Prohibition Act, where it is mandated that whatever the gifts have been given at the time of marriage, you have to maintain a list. So in that list, you are going to have the detailed description of the name of the person, in what way is related to the bride or bridegroom, what property has given as a gift, what is the value of the gift. All these details are entered. Parties to the marriage, they sign, witnesses also they sign, and the copies are given to both the parties. Now what is the intention of maintaining the list is that in case in future there is a case filed with respect to dowry demand, so this list is a documentary evidence which shows that what was the financial capacity of the girl's father, whether he was in a position to give so much articles or the property to the boy. All this can be taken into consideration to decide the case. Now coming back to the dowry law, it says that in case a woman dies within 7 years of marriage, either due to bodily injury, burn in the body, or in an unnatural death, then the presumption is it is dowry death. If it is proved, then the husband and the in-laws who were the parties to the death of the girl will be sentenced to minimum 7 years, and which may extend to the life also. So that is the presumption as far as the dowry prohibition is concerned, as well as we have the dowry prohibition officers are there who can come to the rescue of the women who are subjected to various kind of dowry harassment. Now next, the concluding act what we are going to discuss is called as Domestic Violence Act, Protection of Women Against Domestic Violence Act. Now it is considered as a shield for women against all types of abuses inflicted against her as far as various relations are concerned, right? Now she may be subjected to physical abuse, mental abuse, economic abuse, so on and so forth. But what she has to prove is that the aggrieved person is related through blood, or she is married into the family, or through adoption. So it brings into the gamut all the relations, like it may be a daughter, a daughter-in-law, widow, wife, so on and so forth. So this law is applicable only for women. It is for the protection of women against domestic violence, right? Now what the aggrieved person has to prove under this act is that she is related through blood to the person was inflicted domestic violence, and she was sharing the household, and the person was inflicted the violence or injury, domestic injury, was an adult male member or the adult male member's relatives, right? Now what are the orders can be passed? One is that you may have a protection order. So the court may pass an order protecting the interest of the women, that is the aggrieved person, where it gives a direction to the respondent not to enter the premises where the aggrieved person is staying or the place of work, at no point of time he can disturb the peaceful subsistence or peaceful living. Right? Next one is regarding the compensation. So for whatever the loss of reputation, loss of property, or any damage caused to her, she can recover it from the respondent, and this is a compensatory order. In case she's having a child or children, then she can ask for the custody order. So when you talk about custody order, again we are classifying it where, depending upon the circumstances, the court may give the respondent a visiting right to visit the children frequently, or depending upon the duration what is fixed. Or in case the court finds that in the interest of child it is necessary to prevent the respondent from visiting the child, then it may prevent the respondent from visiting the child. Right? So these are the brief summary about the Hindu Marriage Act. Then we discussed about the remedies, we discussed about the maintenance, and when you talk about marriage, it is inclusive of dowry and the domestic violence. So that's about this provision. Next, our principal V.G. Paraneshwaran, he'll be talking about marriage laws and maintenance as far as the Islamic law is concerned. Thank you.
Namaste all. I am Praneshwaran. I will be adding on to what Dr. Valarmathi had just lectured. She had spoken on the marriage and divorce and maintenance with regard to Hindu law. I will add on to that, and I will be covering these three aspects, that is marriage, divorce and maintenance according to Muslim law. Now to begin with, let me start with marriage. Now unlike Hindu marriage, which is considered as sacrament, at least that is the basic premise, Muslim law is considered to be a civil contract. The definition of Muslim marriage given by one of the scholars is, marriage among Muslims is not sacrament but purely a civil contract. Well, let us try to analyze this, whether it is a civil contract or is it a sacrament like Hindu law. In Hindu law, though we begin with the premise saying that it is sacrament, but then because of the other aspects, because of divorce, somewhere the concept of sacrament loses its veracity, and hence today we see number of divorces. So the question arises whether it is really sacrament. Similarly, under Muslim law, though we start with the premise that it is a civil contract, but there are various other aspects to it which go to show that it may not be purely a civil contract, and it has some social and religious aspects also. Now, why it is said that it is a civil contract is because, like a contract, you have an offer and acceptance. You have something called dower, which is not exactly consideration, but something similar to consideration, and consent of the parties. So when all these things are taken into account, a Muslim marriage is considered to be a civil contract. Whereas there are a couple of other issues like social aspect and religious aspect. Now the social aspect concerning a Muslim marriage is the existence of what is known as a dower or mehr. This is an amount which the husband should promise to give to the wife in respect of her during marriage. Now, if we go by a contract, this is not to be equated as consideration, this is given to the wife or promised to be given to the wife as a mark of respect for her. Then the second aspect of social limitations on a Muslim marriage is the limited polygamy. Now, if it is a civil contract, then the person can enter into a contract any number of times, whereas there is a limited polygamy. In India, a Muslim man can marry a maximum of 4 wives. That is to be interpreted in the sense that it is not only 4 marriages. He can marry any number of times, but then at any given point of time, he can only have a maximum of 4 wives. So there is a limit on polygamy, which again is a social aspect. And then with regard to competency of marriage, who can get married, certain prohibitions are imposed, like he cannot get married within close relationship, which is not to be found in a contract, whereas in a contract you can enter into a contract with anyone. Then among Shia Muslims, there is one restriction. If you are on a pilgrimage, then you cannot get married during pilgrimage. So these are some social aspects which are linked to a Muslim marriage, and hence it may not be purely a civil contract. As regards religious aspect, now Quran does not mandate that a man should marry, but however it is said that it is the duty to get married. And if a person does not get married, he is disobeying the saying of God. Of course, it is not mandated. I repeat, it is not mandated that you should get married or you have to get married. Option is there. But then it is said that it is better you get married. So if you don't follow that, you are going against the saying of God. The second religious aspect is the traditions in Islam. Now, traditions means what are all the practices that were followed. One important tradition is the tradition of the Prophet himself. Now, if you go by those traditions, Prophet himself had married. So, on religious aspects also, there is some effect on marriage. So, keeping in mind these social aspects and religious aspects, it is concluded that it is not purely a civil contract. There are social and religious aspects to a Muslim marriage, but nevertheless we basically start with the premise that it is a civil contract and it has more attributes of a civil contract than other aspects. So hence it may not be a sacrament. And when we come to divorce also, it is said that if the marriage has broken down, then it is better to dissolve the marriage. That is what is said in Quran. So keeping all these aspects in mind, so you have more of civil aspects to a Muslim marriage. Hence, we start with the premise that it is basically a civil contract. Now, in India, the Muslim marriage, also known as nikah, basically the rules apply to all Muslims. And there are various sects or schools in Islam or among Muslims. And depending on which school you belong to, the rules may differ slightly. Wherever there is a difference and which needs to be mentioned, I will be mentioning it. Otherwise, predominantly, the rules of marriage are more or less common to all schools. Basically, there are two schools or two sects in Islam, Sunnis and Shias, and there is also a third sect called Mu'tazila. That in India there are no Mu'tazila sect people, but predominantly Sunnis and Shias. And even among these two sects of Sunnis and Shias, in India predominantly the Sunnis, a large majority are Sunnis, and the Shias are in minority. And within Sunnis, you have 4 schools: Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, and Hanbali. And within Shia, you have Ithna Ashariya, Ismailiya, and Ziyadis. In India, The presumption is you are a Hanafi Sunni unless you show that you belong to some other school or some other sect. Though there are minority population with regard to Shias, when I say minority, the number of people who follow Shia sect are very less, predominantly Sunnis, and among Sunnis belonging to the Hanafi school. Now coming to marriage, which is also called as Nikah, the Quran and traditions and the other sources lay down certain essential elements for a marriage to be valid. There are four elements to a marriage to a Muslim which needs to be followed, and these four elements are competency, consent, formalities and prohibitions. These four elements explain the essentials of a valid marriage, which some of them are positive and some of them are negative. Now each one I will be telling in brief. Competency of parties means the party must be competent to enter into a contract of marriage. Competency is divided into three categories: one, age of majority, sound mind and religion. Now age of majority, the person must be a major, but according to Muslim law in India and some generally also, age of majority is not 18 years or 21 years as the case may be. Among Muslims, for the purpose of marriage, age of majority is age of puberty. So if a person, whether boy or girl, has attained puberty, he has attained a valid marriageable age. And for the purpose of convenience, the courts have held that 15 years, unless proof can be shown otherwise, generally it is presumed to be 15 years. So if a person has attained 15 years of age, he is of a marriageable age. Second, the person must be of sound mind, that is, he must be capable of giving a valid consent in law. And thirdly, the person must be a Muslim. Now among Muslims and the law relating to Muslim marriages, that is Nikah, the persons must be Muslims. It is not necessary that they must belong to the same sect or same school under the sect. Inter-sect and inter-school marriage is allowed as long as you are a Muslim. Irrespective of whichever school or sect you belong, the marriage is valid. So, a Sunni Shafi can marry a Shia Ismailia, completely valid, and vice versa. So, irrespective of which school you belong, as long as you are a Muslim, the marriage is valid. Then a situation arises. A man, a Muslim man, can marry a non-Muslim under certain conditions, but this rule is applicable only to the Sunni sect. A Sunni male can marry a non-Muslim female, but then conditions are the girl must belong to what is known as a Kitabiya sect. Kitabiya means book, that is, they should have some holy book, they should be following a holy book. Now going by the interpretation, it means Christians. So if a Muslim man marries a Christian woman, the marriage is still valid. If a Muslim Sunni male marries a non-Kitabiya girl, then the marriage is irregular. Irregular means it is not void, it is irregular. Once the woman converts herself to Islam, then the marriage becomes valid. So this is with regard to the religion of the parties to a marriage. The second requirement for a valid marriage is consent. Now there must be free consent, obviously. Consent, if it is not free, then the marriage is not valid. But for the Sunni Muslim under the Sunni school, if the consent is by coercion, still the marriage is valid. This one peculiar interpretation is applicable only to the Sunnis, which says that even if consent was procured by coercion, the marriage would still be valid. This is not applicable to Shias. Similarly, fraud and mistake. Fraud, if fraud is played in getting consent, then the marriage is voidable. Thirdly, if there is a mistake as regard to the identity of the parties, then the marriage is void. This is with regard to free consent. The third requirement for a valid marriage are the formalities. Now, when we are talking about formalities, it does not speak about any specific ceremony. What we mean is, what are the requirements or procedures? Like a contract, there must be an offer and acceptance. However, this offer and acceptance must be in the same sitting. What we mean by same sitting is not literally sitting. It should be one after the other immediately. Unlike a contract where you can make the offer today and you can accept the offer tomorrow. In a Muslim marriage, the offer and acceptance must flow immediately one after the other. And it should be understood in the same way, in the sense that what the offer is made, it should be accepted in toto. If there is any reservation or restriction added to the marriage offer, then there is no valid acceptance. This means that the parties need not be present in the same place. The parties to a marriage, that is the boy and the girl, need not be present face to face for making the offer and acceptance. They can be far away. But what is required is one should follow the other immediately. That is, the offer and acceptance must follow the other, one after the other, immediately in the same sitting. That is the requirement. Then obviously the concept of dower must be fixed. Even if it is not fixed, it is presumed that it is fixed. So that is with regard to formal basic formalities. Another requirement is the requirement of witnesses. However, if witnesses are not there, marriage is not void. It is only irregular. At any point of time later on, you can confirm your marriage. The requirement as to witnesses, there must be two male witnesses. If two male witnesses are not there, then one male witness and two female witnesses must be there to a marriage. If witnesses are not there, it is only irregular. At any point of time, you can confirm your marriage. And the last requirement, or rather a negative aspect of the requirement of a Muslim marriage, nikah, is the prohibition. Prohibition is similar to that of kindred or consanguinity that was spoken about under the Hindu law, that is marriage between close relations. The Muslim law prohibits marriage between very close relatives, that is ascendants and descendants. The prohibitions are of two types. One is an absolute prohibition and second is a relative prohibition. Absolute prohibitions, if they are violated, then the marriage is void. Relative prohibitions, if they are violated, marriage is irregular. If the irregularity is removed, the marriage becomes valid. For example, one prohibition is where parties to a marriage, that is either the husband or wife, cannot marry very close relatives of their own. Secondly, they can also not marry very close relatives of their spouses. That is, a husband cannot marry a close relative of a wife, nor the wife marrying a close relative of the husband. For example, under Muslim marriages, a husband cannot marry the wife's sister as long as the marriage between the first sister is subsisting. If he has to marry the sister of his wife, then he has to divorce his wife and then marry her sister. This is a relative prohibition. If he violates this rule, the marriage with the sister of his wife is irregular, and the moment he divorces the first wife, then the other marriage becomes valid. So these are the prohibitions, some of the prohibitions which should not be violated while marrying under Muslim law. Now, after marriage, the next topic is dissolution. Dissolution of a marriage, or commonly called as divorce. Now, dissolution can happen by two fundamental ways: act of God and act of parties. Act of God means when a party to a marriage, that is a husband or wife, dies. So when a person to a marriage, that is either a husband or a wife, dies, the marriage dissolves. In law, what we use the term ipso facto, that means by the very fact. Secondly, the marriage dissolves by the act of parties. The act of parties is what is known as divorce that we are going to discuss. Basically, there are three ways in which marriage can be dissolved. One is by talaq, by the husband. Second is by delegated divorce, that is delegated talaq. And third is by the wife or both the parties. Now, the first form of divorce is known as talaq, what is commonly known as talaq. Here again, talaq is of two types. One is revocable talaq and irrevocable talaq. Yes, I will come to triple talaq in a couple of moments. First, let me explain this concept of talaq. There are two types of talaq. One is a revocable talaq and irrevocable talaq. Now, irrevocable talaq is what is known as the triple talaq that was in news recently. Then you have the revocable talaq. Revocable talaq is where the husband pronounces either his intention or the word talaq once, and thereafter for 3 months he abstains from any relationship with the wife, or when he makes successive pronouncements of talaq once every month, and once he makes the third pronouncement, the divorce becomes absolute. Now, this mode is called revocable because in the first mode, that is when he makes one pronouncement and waits for 3 months, or he makes three successive pronouncements, one after the other, one in each month, there is a chance, there is a possibility for the husband to revoke it. If he revokes, then the divorce does not happen. Hence, it is called as revocable talaq. Now, we are coming to the controversial triple talaq, which is also known as the irrevocable talaq. It happens in one breath and single sitting. The man has to utter the word talaq or his intention of divorcing the wife 3 times. And the wife need not be present also. That is another remarkable feature of this incident. Nevertheless, this form of talaq has now been declared unconstitutional by Supreme Court in 2017 in a case called Sayonara versus Union of India and others. It was a string of cases, writ petitions filed before Supreme Court, in which the Supreme Court has held that triple talaq is unconstitutional. And followed by, you also have a central law which says that if anybody resorts to triple talaq, it is an offense. So this is talaq. The second mode of is delegated talaq, where the husband can delegate his right to divorce his wife to his wife. So she uses the power delegated to him, that is called as delegated talaq. And the third important form of dissolution of marriage is khula and mubarat. Khula is exercised by the wife, where she makes an offer telling that I will give you something in return, you release me from the bondage of marriage. If the husband accepts, then whatever she has promised, she has to give. Usually it is in terms of property or money, and the marriage dissolves. And mubarat is kind of a dissolution by mutual consent. It can originate either from the husband or wife. So this is in brief how a marriage among Muslims can be dissolved. Then maintenance during marriage, maintenance after marriage. During marriage, it is the duty of the husband to maintain his wife. If he does not maintain, the concept of dower will come into place, and the Muslim woman can also demand maintenance. The Muslim woman can also demand maintenance under the Criminal Procedure Code, under section 125 of the Criminal Procedure Code, which is applicable to everyone irrespective of religion. But after the dissolution of marriage, the liability of the husband to maintain his wife is up to a certain period, and that period is known as period of iddat. Iddat means on the dissolution of marriage, either by death or divorce, the wife should remain in seclusion for a certain period. If it is by divorce, then 3 months. If it is by death, then 4 months and 10 days. That is called as a period of iddat. And the husband's duty to maintain his wife after dissolution of marriage extends only to a period of iddat. Beyond iddat, he is not liable to maintain. This is a marked difference from the other forms of law, that is especially in Hindu law, where the husband has a duty to maintain his wife even after divorce. Now, in case husband is not able to maintain, then the close relatives of the wife, the estranged wife, the divorced wife, they have a duty, that is wife's relatives have a duty to maintain. Now, this is a small presentation about giving you a bird's eye view of the concept of marriage, that is nikah, among Muslims. Then what are the essential elements, how marriage can be dissolved, and maintenance that applies to the parties. Thank you very much. After having dealt with the marriage under Hindu law and Muslim law, we need to know that there is one law called the Special Marriages Act, which is applicable in case of inter-religious marriage. Now, this is very important always in case of an inter-religious marriage, that the parties get married under the Special Marriages Act. Now, the Special Marriage Act prescribes a procedure where you go before the sub-registrar of marriages, or rather registrar of marriages, who is usually the sub-registrar of properties who has given the additional charge of registering marriages, submit an application, wait for 30 days and no objections. After 30 days, the marriage is registered and the persons are married. It is open even for persons who belong to Hindus, where both the husband and wife belong to Hindus, or where the parties belong to the same religion, to get married under the Special Marriages Act. But usually, in case of an inter-religious marriage, this is the essential practice and the rule of law, that they get married under the Special Marriages Act to avoid any complications further. Once the parties get married under the Special Marriages Act, irrespective of religion, they will be governed by the Special Marriages Act in terms of all their family law matters. That is, they will no longer be governed by either Hindu law or Muslim law if they are married under the Special Marriages Act. That includes law of divorce, law of maintenance, and the laws of inheritance. So what should be noted is, in case of an interreligious marriage, it is always better to have the marriage registered under the Special Marriages Act. The next topic that will be covered is succession and inheritance, and that will be handled by me.